high desert
in the great American Southwest. Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, whatever the case may be, in all 24 time zones covered now by this program. I'm Art Bell, and the program, of course, is Coast to Coast AM. Glad to have you. Well, I see that our president is planning to announce in several days that the U.S. is going to get out of the 1972 anti-ballistic missile treaty, which means to me we are going to be building anti-ballistic missiles. Now, it is required that we give Russia 6 months' notice before packing it in. With this decision, the president takes the first step toward developing an anti-missile system that he says will protect the U.S. and its allies from missiles fired by rogue nations. Russia and the U.S. have warned Bush that withdrawing may trigger a nuclear arms race. Now, that's interesting, and I suppose if you put yourself in the shoes of the Russians or the Chinese, they don't necessarily have the technical capability to build an anti-missile system, but they do have nuclear weapons perched at the end of ballistic missiles. So there's a little bit of danger window here, because if you've got them, if you figure the U.S. is going to be able to successfully build a shield, then, of course, if you've got them, you better use them or you'll lose them. That certainly would be one mode of thinking if you put yourself in the enemy's, the potential opposition's shoes. He corrects himself. So, I don't know. Good idea, bad idea, what do you think? The Tora Bora area, U.S. B-52s are just bombing the hell out of Tora Bora. They believe that Al-Qaeda top dogs and maybe even Osama himself, may be there. A lot of confusion at this hour in Tora Bora, because there was an initial report that the Al-Qaeda forces were surrendering. They had been given a deadline, and they were surrendering, and now that report appears to be at this hour in question, so nobody knows for sure. But if they don't, of course, the B-52s will crank back up again. You'll probably see a bunch of bunker busters go off, and all hell will break loose. We'll just have to wait and see. Confusion always in situations of war. Senators who apparently have had the opportunity to review the videotape presentation of Osama bin Laden whooping it up over the September 11th attacks are saying when it is released, and they're thinking that it may be released very shortly, next day or two, it's going to convince all of us that he is the one who was responsible for those attacks. They find him grinning and marveling at the destruction and death of the 11th. We could see it perhaps as early as tomorrow. And in the first criminal indictment stemming from what happened September 11th, a federal prosecutors today charged a French-Moroccan man who, get this, was in jail a month before the attacks with conspiring with Osama bin Laden to murder thousands in the suicide hijackings. It's a 30-page indictment. Federal agents seized computers in 27 cities today. They went a hacker hunting, and they found them. 27 U.S. cities where people are putting copyrighted software, Microsoft Windows and all that sort of thing, up on the Internet for all who would download it. Operation Buccaneer. you get the pirate connotation there, right? Operation Buccaneer was directed at 62 people in Australia, Finland, England, Norway, and right here in the good old U.S. of A. Federal Reserve cut the interest rate a quarter point today, and everybody went, hoo-hoo-hoo. Didn't impress anybody. Now, the other news. You're not going to believe this, but the security guards at Area 51, known affectionately and not so affectionately as Camo Dudes, C-A-M-O, Camo Dudes, walked off their jobs Monday in Las Vegas at the covert military installation known as Area 51, a place they said they can't talk about. The union president, Vernon Hall, said, when asked about where he worked as he and more than a dozen other striking security officers displayed on strike signs on Haven Street near McCarran International Airport, quote, use your imagination. Where do I work? Use your imagination. That is where nondescript passenger jets, known only as Janet planes, very routinely take the guards and other workers to the installation on the dry bed of Groom Lake, 90 miles north of Las Vegas, a place they referred to only as nowhere, in quotes, and, in quotes, out of town. Hall, leader of the Security Police Association of Nevada, an in-house collective bargaining unit, said the association's members decided to go on strike after 3 months of negotiations for a new contract with their employer, EG&G. Said the issues include lack of adequate wages and benefits and a lot of overtime. And so, let us think about this. The people who guard Area 51 are on strike. Now, I've known a lot of people who have tried to get close to Area 51. There are certain mountaintops and areas where one can get a glimpse, but inevitably you are harassed by camo dudes. By the way, that name comes from the camouflage stuff they wear when they're working. And they'll find you. I mean, you'll see vehicles approaching, and they will scare the you-know-what out of you. They'll get you out of there. And actually, it is an area where, you know, if you decide to violate the security, you can be shot dead. But now that they're on strike, you might imagine that anybody who was thinking of trying to get into the installation to see what's going on might, during this period of time, decide to take advantage of the strike and take a stroll in there. A lot of stories about people who have made it into the area, people who have flown over the area. Not a good thing to do, by the way. And then when you do land, if you don't get shot down, you are, you know, you're talked to for a long time. And now tonight we're going to be doing something on Bigfoot. Tomorrow night we're going to be doing something on what's under the earth. I think you're going to find that really interesting. A Native American tomorrow night. Listen to this. Good day to you, Art. I was up visiting your site. This is a Native American writing this. And I was amazed at some of the drawings on shadow people that others have sent to you. I'm Cherokee, part Irish, considered a shadow walker. And I'm sure there are others out there just like me. I just have yet to meet any. And by the way, looking at the drawings on your site, now I'm sure of it. There are different types of walkers out here, though. But with what your listeners are drawing, it appears about 75% of them are seeing shadow walkers. Shadow walking is kind of like astral travel, just a lot more intense. It can be done while awake, which most will, for example, do it unknowingly while they're sleeping. It's hard to explain, but to give an example of this gift, it's like a extremely strong, vivid visualization. I say vivid because you're able to touch, feel, and interact with other beings on different planes. But I feel it's really intended to help or protect others, never meant to harm or scare. So your listeners could be seeing another type of shadow person too. Skinwalkers, for example. They pretty much look like a shadow walker, but to the natives, they mean trouble. These walkers are considered shadow stealers. According to the elders, once you are attacked by a skinwalker, there is nothing you can do to stop it. But no one has told me what may happen if you're attacked by one. It does, at times, seem like something from a Twilight Zone. But believe me, it's very real. We do exist. We do exist. And there's a lot more to this story, but later. Namaste, Art. Signed, Shadow Bear. Thought that was pretty interesting. It would resonate with quite a few of you out there. My name is Steve, writes Steve, logically. And I've only listened to your show for about 30 minutes ever last night, though. For some reason, I tuned into your show by accident, talking about entity attacks by shadow people. And I'm a person, Art, who refuses to believe anything that sounds that crazy. I'm what you might refer to as a skeptic's skeptic, which is why I'm writing to you now. I think that I may have been experiencing something very similar to what your audience has recounted. My experience took place about 2 days ago. I was in the hospital with my wife because our one-month-old daughter was admitted due to a high fever she had, well, about 11 p.m., when I pulled out the recliner that is provided in the room and converted it to my bed for the night. I was asleep on my belly dreaming about various things that are currently too faded to recount. What I can recall vividly during my dream, I had become aware of my surroundings. Almost simultaneously, I felt an evil presence in the room. I was frozen with fear and didn't move a muscle, hoping it was just a bad dream. All of a sudden, I felt the mattress sink in as if someone had knelt on it. Oh, God. I then, he goes on, really panicked, but was still paralyzed. What came next really left an impression on me. It happened so quickly, frightening. I saw two black, featureless hands and arms grab each of mine and felt a body lay on top of mine. When this happened, I was engulfed by this infinite blackness and impeded any movement or breathing. I instantly thought, oh God, I have just died. This is what it is to be dead. And I began to mourn the fact that I would never see my family again. Just as I was giving in to the situation, I thought to myself that if I'm able to think that I am not dead at all, then if I can think I'm not dead at all. I then began to attempt to shake my head and succeeded. When I was able to move, I was released immediately from its grasp and felt as if I had woken from a deep sleep, looked around for any sign of the being, and found nothing. I found it kind of amazing that this topic came up on your show just days after my experience. And I guess this man now wants a skeptic's skeptic, he said, is something of a believer. Things erupting from the earth in strange places. Very strange places indeed. If you listen very carefully, that's the topic coming up in a moment. Now, guess what? Today, KNYE, my radio station here in Pahrump, 95.1 on the FM dial, got in its T-shirts. That's right, we made T-shirts. And if you would like to see it, if you'll look at my webcam right now, artbell.com, and the webcam photo, you'll see me proudly wearing my new T-shirt, my 95.1 KNYE T-shirt. We also got, it's kind of cool, we got bumper stickers that we're going to begin to give away. We got, we've got coffee mugs coming and all kinds of goodies. They're on the way. But if you'll take a look at my webcam, you will see our logo on my T-shirt. I love black T-shirts. I've always loved, and I hate white T-shirts. For camera stuff, if you take a picture of a white T-shirt, it looks like a white blur. It's awful. But black T-shirts, on the other hand, I don't know. It's just something about them. What's coming out of the earth that ought not be? Or maybe it is normal. There's a big Arctic eruption going on at the Gackle Ridge. And they've got magma coming up from the earth's mantle. It's said to be rather exciting to be the first scientist to observe a volcanic eruption in an ultra-slow-spreading mid-ocean ridge, an event in and of itself that rarely occurs. Even better is discovering that the USS Hawkbill, which is a submarine equipped with scientific mapping tools, just happened to have been passing by at the same time and recorded the whole event, while the scientists on board were completely unaware of the eruption. Intense seismic activity began at Gackle Ridge in January of 1999 and continued for 7 months. The Gackle Ridge, again, the slowest spreading ridge in the world, located in the Arctic Basin. Initial reports suggest, published in on February 15th in Nature, have sparked much interest in the area, culminating in the recent excursion of the U.S. Coast Guard icebreaker Healy. So they're really, really interested in what might be going on, or what is, correction, is going on beneath the frigid waters of the Arctic. We have a lot of subs up there. I've got a kind of an interesting story here about cell phones. You know, cell phones are not my favorite thing in the world. And now, maybe I like them even less. The article says, it's from Reuters News, and an expert has been quoted as saying that cell phones are spooking ghosts. Mobile phones are killing off ghosts, according to a British expert who spent years researching the occult on Sunday. Said on Sunday, Tony Cornell of the Society for Psychic Research told the Sunday Express newspaper that reports of ghost sightings had begun to actually decline. And when did it happen? When mobile phones were introduced 15 years ago. So there is the possibility that microwaves at about that frequency affect ghostly entities. So, you know, suggesting this story might have something to it. If one of you out there, or many of you, are haunted by some sort of entity, you might want to have the cell phone near your bed. And if something begins to approach in the night, as we heard in that email I read a moment ago, you might just want to pop your cell phone on and, I don't know, call some kind of number. And perhaps the radiation will save you or scare away whatever it is. According to the newspaper, haunted tourist attractions in Britain could be in trouble because the ghosts are going because of cell phones. They could be under threat if the number of cell phones continues to grow from the present figure of 39 million. Apparently, paranormal events, which some scientists put down to unusual electrical activity, could be perhaps drowned out by the electronic noise produced by phone calls and text messages. Now, isn't that interesting? Paranormal events, which some scientists put down to unusual electrical activity, could be drowned out by the electronic noise produced by cell phones and or computers of varying sorts. So in other words, in one way, if you think about it, the more technical we become, the more technical society becomes, the
some velvet morning when I'm straight, I'm gonna open up your gate and maybe tell you about Phaedra and how she gave me life and how she made velvet morning when I'm straight.
Call
Bart Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903.
Some velvet morning when I'm straight, I'm gonna open up your gate.
Good morning from the high desert. Our lines are open.
And maybe tell
Phaedra.
Phaedra.
You like that name, Phaedra?
How
I do too.
We're
going to do open lines, and then top of the hour, we're going to be talking with Robert Morgan, the Bigfoot researcher, Robert Morgan. And I think I've got a couple of surprises lined up for you. And with you, into the night we go. On the first time caller line, you are on the air. Hello. Hello. Going once. Going twice. Gone. Wildcard line, you're on the air. Hi.
Hi. This is Julie from Kansas City.
How you doing, Julie?
Fine. How are you?
Okay.
I was wondering if it's just me or if anybody else has noticed that on all the commercials and TV lately, we have these alien commercials, and they're like trying to get us used to them. And
oh, yeah.
So we don't notice. Like, they're integrating them into society, so they'll just... In the future, they'll be like our buddies.
Absolutely no question about it. So that one day, if we do hear about aliens arriving or see it on the nightly news with Mr. Brokaw, it will not be such a shock to us because we've been seeing it in movies and television and, hearing about it on my program. And
it's really gotten bad in commercials.
Yes, I know. Okay, I know. Well, I think there's a reason for all that. I think you're right.
I was just wondering if anybody else had noticed that but me. How long do you think it's going to take before that happens? 5, 10 years?
You mean before we get an official visit?
Or before we get officially that they're around us and we're not supposed to even notice them.
Well, that could be. They could be around us. There is a large group of people. There are many who believe that they are here now. That they are all among us right now. Now, I don't know if I'm one of those people. Well, I might be. And as far as when we will be first officially visited, I don't know. I really don't know. However, if you take the crop circles in Great Britain, the most recent ones, the face, the glyph, into consideration, then it might be getting pretty close because it's gone from a sort of, hey, guess what this is, folks, to more of a, here's what this is, folks. And I suppose the next step, obviously, from there would be some sort of presence or arrival. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Top of the morning to you.
Art?
Yes.
Hey, I wanted to ask you if anybody out there, any of the experts on Champ, Lake Champlain, if there's any kind of a pattern for him when he shows up in the summertime, because my family and I, we'd like to go, you know, just a camp, stay like at a...
When who shows up, sir?
Champ, the lake monster.
Well, I'm not intimately familiar with Champ, so is there a schedule for Champ?
It seems like in the summertime there's more sightings, and I was kind of curious this past summer if there was any kind of...
Sir, I'm not even familiar with Champ. What does Champ look like?
I believe he... Have you ever heard of Caddy? Off the... he's off the West Coast?
No.
Ogopogo.
Well, try and give me a visual of... If I were to see Champ face to
snout,
or whatever.
There's two species, they believe,
yes,
that they've seen. One looks like the classic Loch Ness monster type, and I believe a woman took a picture in 1976. Massey took a picture of one of it, and then the other one is it's supposed to be a primitive whale.
Then slightly reminiscent of a sea serpent, I guess. sort of reminiscent vaguely of a serpent and a little bit of dinosaur thrown in, huh?
Right. Mm-hmm. The American Indians sense. The individual that discovered Lake Champlain, explorers and stuff, it's been recorded all through history. But it seems to me that there's like a pattern when this thing shows up. But now, you know, the lake is open to the ocean.
So it may well be that Champ comes and goes as Champ pleases.
Correct. Maybe breeding, or it comes in there, you know, for certain reasons in the summertime. And that's when they have the highest sightings, is around July and August. Well, I was wondering if anybody really knew if there was a pattern.
No, I understand. Are you looking to be in the company of Champ?
Well, we'd like to camp up there, you know, like Port Henry. That's supposed to be a real hot spot for him. And I knew an Onondaga Indian, actual Indian, who had seen Champ, eyeball to eyeball.
You do want a meeting then, don't you?
I don't know if I want to meet him right up close. I just want to take a look at him at a distance, you know.
Well, one thing's for sure. If it's mating time, you don't want to get in the way of Mr. Champ and potential Mrs. Champ. That wouldn't be good.
No, but I'm just wondering if anybody out there, any experts this past summer, if there's been any...
All right. Well, you've asked enough. They'll answer, I'm sure. Thank you very much for the call. Sure, those of you who know something about Champ in Lake Champlain would be able to answer that question. We are going to be talking about, I don't know, what is Bigfoot, you know? What is Bigfoot? Is Bigfoot a monster? Is Bigfoot a dimensional being? Is Bigfoot simply something that has been here all the time? Or much longer than we have and continues to exist in a sort of an interesting existence, one that is neither fully here nor fully there because of the nature of sightings and the fact that we don't have any bodies yet. West of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Yes, Art. Art?
Yes.
Yeah, Bob in L.A.?
Yes, Bob.
When you and Linda and the other people start talking about that city off the coast of Cuba, I broke out my Reader's Digest Great World Atlas.
Yeah.
And I was starting to look at Cuba, and then my eyes passed up to the page previous to that, on Mexico, and the Yucatan Peninsula. And something struck my eye. About 50 miles off the coast of Mexico and the Yucatan Peninsula, there's a perfect circle, a 375-mile diameter circle, that's centered about 93 degrees and 40 minutes west latitude, and about 21 degrees and 30 minutes north latitude. Now, at one time, they had postulated that about 50 million years ago, a huge meteor struck the Earth. And that's
made that circle, yes.
Right. That's possibly what sunk, you know, the dinosaurs. Now, if you look at the Gulf of Mexico, I don't think the Gulf of Mexico was there at that time.
Mm-hmm.
Because if the meteor struck there and you track it, the Gulf of Mexico to the northeast,
yes,
it heads right up towards the Bermuda Triangle.
Right.
Now, if that meteor entered into the Earth, and they say some postulate that it actually penetrated the Earth's crust, now that would have left a huge open borehole right down through there.
Absolutely.
Now, you move forward about 49,990,000 years.
And here we are.
And all of a sudden, you have people there, and it had subsided, the water came in, or there was just land there, and we had another cataclysmic event happen, and that particular area sank, 2,200 feet.
It is as good a guess, sir, as any, or as good a scenario as any. Right now, everybody is predictably in an uproar. As I read you last night, some British scientists are all upset about Paulina Zelitsky's find, and they don't like it. They don't want to hear about it. They don't want to think that everything they have thought previously could be all wrong, and they could be all wet. And, you know, there could have been people running around on Earth long before any of them said it could be. What kind of tragedy, personal one, for them, would that be? A very serious one. So they have huffed and puffed and blown at Ms. Zelitsky's house, but she said, look, it's just fact. You know, you're not here in Cuba. You're in Great Britain. And so what the hell do you know? We have fact here. And we can prove what we're saying. So I guess the report so long ago was right. The ones affected most negatively by change of any sort, aliens arriving, Earth's history, man's history, the ones who will be affected in the most negative, dire way will be the scientists who have postulated their theories as fact about when man first walked and all the rest of it. I mean, they're going to be so, so upset. West of the Rockies, you are on the air. Good morning.
Hey, Art, this is Michael from Bakersfield.
Hello, Michael.
I noticed you had, about 2 years ago, you had a guest on named Reverend Andre Schlesinger from the Church of Satan in San Francisco.
I remember, yes.
And at the end of the show, you said you were going to have him back on.
Uh-huh.
Did you ever have him back on?
No, not yet, but I'd certainly have him back on. I will have, to the distress of many, just about anybody on who's interesting. Church of Satan, regular churches, you name it. I'll do any of it. But I just haven't thought about it lately, but I'd have him back on. He was a good guest.
Yeah, he was. I really enjoyed him.
Are you a follower?
Not really, no. He was just very interesting.
Are you a potential follower?
I don't think so. I just found him interesting.
All righty, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, and take care. East of the Rockies, you are on the air. Turn your radio off, please. There you go. You're in a truck, I bet.
Yeah, I'm in a truck.
Just a guess. What's up, sir, and where are you?
I'm Dale, and I'm in Cleveland, Ohio right now. And I've just got a question for you, Art. It's about the Osama bin Laden situation. You know, Osama bin Laden is a pretty intelligent individual, wouldn't you say?
Probably is, yes.
Mm-hmm. I mean, to take 15 men or so and bring them over here and keep them undercover for 2 years and all that.
Yes.
He's got some people under him that are, I'd say their IQ is above average, wouldn't you think?
Perhaps so.
Well, given that, and if you was to go and take out the World Trade Centers, and it being, like I said, being as intelligent as he is, wouldn't you think he would have a plan B after, in fact, he did what he did?
Oh, absolutely.
He basically sat over there in the Middle East and waited for us to just mow him down, and we're doing that.
Look, to answer your question, absolutely yes. Of course he has a plan B, an escape of some sort. Or perhaps, on the other hand, he plans to be martyred, to allow himself to be martyred. Well, he's getting real close to that. If he's in Tora Bora, he's about to be shredded. If they haven't really surrendered, and again, at this hour, we don't know. There are reports of a surrender pending, but now that seems to be falling apart. And from war fronts and from front lines, you rarely get good, clean news. And even the authorities sometimes don't know what's going on. So either there is going to be a surrender or... the B-52s are going to do their carpet thing, and some of those big bunker busters are going to fall. It's already a wreck over there, and Taliban's on the run, no question about it. But it's sort of the last stronghold, the last big fight. There'll be a lot of mop-up to do and probably a great deal of guerrilla warfare that will follow. But the last big fight is either about to happen or there's going to be a surrender. The hours ahead will tell. First-time caller line, you're on the air. Hello.
Yes, Art. That's Dwight from Moose Jaw, Saskatchewan.
Hi, Dwight. How are you?
Good, good. What I phoned about was something that happened to me many, many years ago, 25 years ago. I was at the farm visiting my parents, and my brothers and I, my dad decided to sit down and play with the Ouija board.
Yes, yeah. Yes.
Well, something really strange happened where... on the farm there, there's a big square out on the property. It used to be part of the old Red River Trail. And it's recessed square in the ground. And then inside that, there's another recessed square outline. And we got playing with the Ouija board anyway, and this Chief Buffo come through through the Ouija board and said that he had been massacred or murdered and buried out between by this buffalo rubbing stone.
That's a lot of moving around on that board to explain all of that.
Well, it through the process of over an hour that this happened. And we had a backhoe out there in the next couple of days, and we went out, and every time we went out, tried to dig up this stone, and around this stone, it would start to rain. Now, as strange as that may seem, but that's one of the strangest things I ever come across.
So, did you dig up the stone?
No, we just eventually just left it the hell alone.
In other words, you took that as a hint?
Yeah.
Do not touch the stone.
Yeah, for sure.
All right, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much for the call. Wildcard Line, you're on the air. Good morning.
Hi, Art. My name's Ryan. I'm calling from Concord, North Carolina.
Hello, Ryan.
Hey, I just wanted to make a quick comment on the story you read earlier about the fewer ghost sightings since the introduction of mobile phones.
Cell phones, yes.
Yeah. Something that almost concerns me is the fact that there's also reports that cell phones cause cancer, things like that.
Yes.
It makes me wonder that even though it's nice to know there might be a way to protect yourself from, you know, entity attacks and things like that, kind of concerns me that you might actually be scrambling certain lesser used parts of your brain at the same time.
Well, I know, but how frequently are you attacked by an entity? After all, if you had a cell phone handy and you could use it as a defense, you know, like holy water or whatever, just flip open your cell phone and radiate a little RF and away it goes. But you know, there is one less soul to feed. I mean, where is this entity going, and what are you doing to it with these frequencies?
Well, my concern really would be is not so much that you're doing something to the entity, but that you're just making it impossible for any interaction, which would kind of...
Yeah, but that's one conclusion. Another might be that you are somehow destroying an entity.
Oh, yeah, that's definitely also a possibility.
Well, cell phones had to be good for something. Thank you very much for the call, sir, and take care. I don't like them. I mean, begging your indulgence, not this last caller, but the caller previous was on a cell phone. Now, I ask you, is the way that sounded, in your opinion, a step forward for technology and civilization, or is it a step backward? I maintain it is a step backward, and I wish these cell phone companies would get their act together and make it sound like real communication instead of something coming through, you know, Rod Serling's chest. I'm so down on cell phones. But on the other hand, if they'll shoo away an attacking entity, then perhaps they have some good. East of the Rockies, you're on the air. Hello.
Oh, yeah, Art. This is Tony. I'm in West Virginia.
And on a cell phone, too, aren't you?
Yeah, I am.
All right. What's up?
Yeah, I was thinking about that thing you were talking about with Mars and how it's supposed to be heating up.
Yes, sir. Turn your radio off. Yes, Mars, they say, will heat up and the poles will melt. And they say this will occur because of the increased heat from the sun. And my nagging question is, well, then, how about third rock from the Earth? The sun, you know, good old Earth here. How about us? If they're going to be affected that way, then what's it going to do to us?
Well, the only thing I was thinking was maybe the reason it might heat Mars up more than the Earth is because they don't really have an atmosphere right now.
Well, that's true, but I would think an atmosphere would absorb heating. I mean, after all, we absorb heat and radiation quite readily from the sun.
Well, okay.
Right?
I was thinking it might not heat it up that much. It just might be enough where it'll melt their caps, and then they'll have a little bit of atmosphere, and then it'll stop heating up.
Well, maybe. Or perhaps, as I said the other evening, there is another possibility, and that is that depending on the sun's cycle, or cycles within cycles, it may be that every now and then Mars becomes the habitable cool place to be with an atmosphere and water and all the rest of it. And then Earth becomes the not-so-cool in more ways than one place to be, and, frankly, not-so-habitable. And maybe it's a big race to see whether we can get transportation for most of us from here to there before it happens.
Bell in the Kingdom of Nye. From west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may recharge at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To recharge on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903.
Good morning. From the high desert, coming up, Robert W. Morgan. It's all about Bigfoot, folks, and I think I've got a couple of surprises for you toward the bottom of the hour. We'll see. Robert Morgan is a Bigfoot researcher, founder of the American Anthropological Research Foundation. Robert's initial encounter took place in 1957 in Mason County, Washington, when he came face to face with something he considered, in quotes, a giant gorilla following his stint in the U.S. Navy and his education as a data processing systems engineer for the FAA. Robert launched a career both in filmmaking and the search for the truth behind the Bigfoot. He recruited a 17-member science advisory board that included many luminaries before organizing six of the most scientific expeditions ever formed in America. Backed by the National Wildlife Federation and other private parties, his 1974 expedition resulted in the classic film The Search for Bigfoot and his inclusion in the record-setting Smithsonian series Monsters, Myth, or Mystery. His photographs have appeared in many publications, including Arthur C. Clarke's works, Parade Magazine, and multiple other works, has appeared on many TV and radio shows, including repeatedly here. In addition, several Native American dignitaries have assisted Robert. Robert Morgan, coming up. And now here is Robert Morgan. Robert, welcome to the program.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for calling me and inviting me back.
Oh, it's just great to have you back. Well, I consider you sort of the ultimate Bigfoot guy. And I know there's a whole community of Bigfoot researchers out there. I might add, not all of whom love each other.
That seems evident sometimes. And that's sad, isn't it?
Yeah, I was going to ask you about that. Why is that? You know, it's sort of a... Seems like there's a lot of, jealousy and infighting, you know, just like in the UFO community, and maybe any community for that matter. Among those who speak to the issue, there's just a lot of infighting. How come?
Well, you know, this goes, at first, when I first encountered it, I thought that it was a strictly an ego thing, and I thought that perhaps it was because some of the, I called them so-called researchers, we're more into the research to gather limelight to themselves, to attract attention to themselves. A lot of them were from very small towns, and they were the big man on campus, so to speak.
Mm.
And they really had no academic credentials behind them. They had no really formulated plan of any sort. And so I thought, well, gee, maybe it's just because there aren't really a lot of scientists involved. But then the more I got involved with science in other facets, I discovered that there's a great amount of professional jealousy in the scientific community. And I think one of the greatest, I think, disservices has been done to Dr. Grover Krantz at Washington State University, a comparative anatomist and a very well-educated man. And his book, The Track of Bigfoot, things like this, and his reports, he was really castigated by his peers. And many of the people that form my science advisory board, one in particular, Dr. Carlton S. Kuhn, who is professor emeritus at Penn State, and he wrote a book that is now passed by because we've learned, you know, as we've gone on. It was called The Races of Man. They also suffered the same thing, but at a different level. So I guess it just comes down that that a lot of human beings are just jealous and small-minded, and I guess that's the way they are.
Maybe that's why Bigfoot won't have much to do with us.
I don't blame them, you know. As I've said so many times, you know, people talk about Bigfoot this and Bigfoot that, and I say, well, you know, the one thing about them, I've never heard of them raping a child, kidnapping anyone. I've never heard of them breaking into a car, stealing it. I don't think they use dope, you know. And it goes on and on and on. They've never declared war on anyone.
Maybe they have just observed our civilization at afar for a while and decided contact is better not made.
Well, I think that is absolutely true. I think that the more they have observed us, and yet they have watched the gentler side of us, and they've been seen many times. There's a school teacher in a small rural town in Ohio who have seen Bigfoot families, a small family, I'm not talking about anything large, but three or four at a time, come just outside the periphery of vision of most people near her small country school. It's down in the Amish country. And she was quite straightforward, and she said, yes, I've seen them now. They've been back 2 or 3 years, and they come down, and they sit just out inside the woods and watch the children play. And I think that's fascinating. Another thing was old-time engineers on some of the smaller roads would tell me of them being seen watching the trains go by, just sitting on the bank and watching. And right here in Montana, not too long ago, in a pass, it's called Marias Pass, the engineers have seen the Bigfoot families.
Well, you know, I was kind of kidding, Robert, but maybe I'm really right. I mean, maybe they have observed us. They know what we seem to be all about. And other than the occasional approach of the more gentle, they stay away.
I think it was funny to say, but simultaneously, I think there's a lot of truth to it. The more they see of the little hairless people who scream at just about anything, and if you go into the national parks and view us from afar, you know, here's this beautiful wilderness and all these majestic things, and here comes a family screaming, yelling, dropping gum wrappers and things like that. We're not necessary. As a matter of fact, in anthropology, the more I've studied it, as I've said so many times, I've learned more about my fellow man than I have about Bigfoot simply by watching their reactions, and we're not necessarily an admirable race.
Back in 57, when you were hunting, you saw your first, but you originally reported what you saw not as Bigfoot or as something distinctly different, but as a gorilla. Where was that, and what do you recall about it now?
Well, I was in the state of Washington, and I had been aboard the USS Princeton, a warfare aircraft carrier. And after being imprisoned aboard ship
right.
for a tour of the Far East, I took any chance to go to the woods. And I had gone up with a friend of mine up in Mason County, and he turned to the right, and I went to the left. And I say I was hunting because I had a gun and all that stuff, but I really had no interest in hurting anything. I just was out there. And something came down through the brush. I guess it was around 9 o'clock in the morning, and I heard it. And I finally stood up, and it was something good size that was in the brush. I couldn't see what it was, and I finally called out, and all of a sudden it just went dead silent. And first time in my life, every hair on my body stood up, and I couldn't quite figure it out. Why was I concerned? I was the guy with the gun, right? And
when a large animal goes dead silent, it could mean, I suppose, a lot of things. It could mean it's protecting itself by becoming silent, or I suppose it could mean it's decided to stalk you.
It's very possible. I think that in the subsequent events, I think I shocked it. I think it was not expecting me.
Okay.
And I think I really shocked it. I mean, here's the master woodsman of the Bigfoot, and all of a sudden up pops this little strange character. And finally he took off through the brush, and when he got to a point where he could see me, he turned around. And I thought I was looking, and I used this with tongue-in-cheek. He reminded, the look, expression on his face reminded me of Sonny Liston after he picked himself up off the floor when Muhammad Ali got through with him. You know, he was surprised and not very happy.
Well, you've had years to dig up that analogy. That's pretty good, though.
But he looked at me, and I looked at him, and to this day, I've even tried hypnotherapy. I don't know who left first, but my money is on me. And when I got back to the car, my hunting partner showed up from the opposite direction, and he never would speak to me about what happened to him. All I knew is he showed up the same time I did, and we got in the car, and we left. And when we got down to the very first place, we got some breakfast, and I tried to report it. And this is standard operational procedure. I called the State Highway Patrol, and they said, I think you better call the sheriff.
Really? Really?
Yeah, so I called the sheriff, and they took down all the information. And the more I listened to their questions, the more I thought, now, wait a second, I have about 4 months to go before I'm going out of the Navy, right?
Right.
And I thought they were going to send somebody down with a little white coat. So I just exited stage left, and I'm sorry that I did. But
yeah, you can tell from the way people ask questions. You really can. There becomes a certain sort of tone in their voice, right?
Oh, definitely. They were obviously there was more than one person listening. You know,
well, of course.
And I'm a dumb kid from Ohio. I was from Canton, a steel town. I had never heard of Bigfoot. I had no clue. And I kept telling them that, as if I was talking, I said, look, you got to understand, you have a gorilla loose up here. I saw it. There is no question there is a gorilla loose up here. There's a circus been through here. Somebody lost their gorilla.
Mm-hmm. were you with another party up there, sir, to which I'm sure you'd say yes? Were you and your friend celebrating in the woods? I mean, kind of question. I know.
Sorts of things. And I thought, nah, this isn't worth it. So when I got back, I went on with the idea. In fact, I told some of my shipmates, I saw a gorilla up there. Yeah, right, you know. So I figured I did what any other red-blooded American boy would do at a place that term like that. I shut up.
Mm.
And went back, and it was a couple of years later, I was reading the, remember the old Argosy and True magazines?
I do.
Yes, well, I loved those magazines. And I was reading that, and that's when I started reading about the Bigfoot from Northern California. And I thought, oh my God, that's what I saw. And then when I heard people starting laughing and chuckling and making fun of it, I thought, no. So I did like a lot of people again. You know, we all have these lists. One of these days I'm gonna, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And the list went on and on. But that was part of my list. And finally, one day I said, let's do it.
Okay, well, I mean, you must have known, though, somewhere in some part of your mind that what you saw really was not exactly a gorilla, or you would not have proceeded the way you did.
No, well, that's true. But, you know, it's like if you take someone from the desert and you show them a tall smoke tree, and that's the only tree they've ever seen. Then you take them to the redwoods. They're in tough shape.
It's interesting you should mention that. I am from the desert as an adult. You know, I love the desert. It's my place to be, and I just love it. And I happened to go visit Bob Crane of the Sea Crane Company, a friend of mine. He lives up there among the redwoods. I mean, the big, big.
There you go.
And it creeped me out, Robert. It totally creeped me out. I mean, the redwoods were so high that going down the highway, a satellite dish could not see the southern sky or much of anything else. I mean, it just was it was freaky.
Something that's always puzzled me is how anyone could have ever put a saw against a redwood tree. I've never understood that.
Money?
I suppose, but that's another thing I've never understood, is doing things just for the money. Our heartbeats are finite. They're not infinite. They're finite. We have a certain amount of heartbeats.
Yeah, but a lot of people aren't counting, Robert.
I guess. I count every single one of them, and I have for a long time. But I was a kid from Ohio, and I had no way of making a comparison. I had to compare it with something that I knew about. And there was that one gorilla that always fascinated me, Gargantua. And so that's the only equation I could make at the time.
You organized a whole bunch of what would you call them? Expeditions is what you'd call them. You took people out for magazines, got involved with magazines, took people out in hunt of, looking for this creature, right?
Well, not in the beginning. My very first trip, I was going alone. I had moved to Miami, Florida, and I organized myself. I always wanted to live in Miami, and I'd worked with the FAA, and I had some problems there that I just couldn't tolerate. They were buying useless parts for 86,000% markup, things like this, and I discovered it. And my position was fairly responsible, and I just couldn't handle that.
Mm-hmm.
So I realized the air traffic control system was in serious trouble. Met a fellow by the name of F. Lee Bailey. I'm sure you've heard of him.
I've spoken with F. Lee.
Yes, and he and Ed Giannotta, he had formed Petco, which unfortunately ran up against Ronnie Reagan. But I spoke to him, and I just couldn't go on. And they said, well, why don't you resign, write a book? So I did. It was called The Life Jugglers. But anyway, it was about the situation. I got to Miami, and I thought, I'm going to the mountains. And I had run a statistical program. And I had chosen places in America, or in North America, actually, where the ecology had not necessarily changed, not essentially, and that the systems, the ecosystems, could still support a life form such as that.
Yeah, I guess you could sit down with a topographical, a really good map, and basically look at the totally isolated probable places.
Yep, and you factor in things like Indian legends and recent sightings and just all sorts of things. I had a lot of fun. I had a lot of late night times and working with the computers. So I was able to write these little programs and run this thing. And it was testing the computer, and at the same time it was doing some good. And so I decided to go by myself. And I was going in the month of March because I figured they were going to come out of wherever they were, and they had to leave tracks. And little Bobby was going to be there on his snowshoes. So I set this up, and two fellows found out I was going. They said, nah, you're not going by yourself. We're going with you. And so that's how it began. And when we got back, I was petitioned by Ivan Tour Studios. You remember the people that made Gentle Ben and all that?
Sure.
So the president called me. It got in the newspapers because one of the guys had a big mouth. And I was just doing it for myself. I didn't even think the public would have any interest at all. Well, indeed they did. And Bill Grafay was the president of Ivan Tours at the time. He called me, said, I'd like to have lunch with you. So I went up, and like a dummy, I went up and sat down and talked to him. And the more things went, of course, then the National Wildlife Federation called me, and everything is history from that point.
During any one of these expeditions, did you find what you were looking for?
Oh, yes. Oh, absolutely. As a matter of fact, on that very first trip, that program that I wrote, Works in Magic, the very first night, this is hard to believe, but there were two other guys with me.
Mm-hmm.
All we had was a map. I'd never been to this part of the state of Washington before. Up toward Trout Lake, we had driven to the end of the road.
Oh, yes.
And the snow was above the camper on my pickup truck. I got on the roof of that. We jumped off into the snow, and we went walking. It was such a beautiful night. We struck tracks, two sets, and there was a smaller one next to a larger one. We could not match the stride of the larger one, heading toward Sleeping Woman Mountain, which is a wilderness area.
Now, these were tracks of 2 feet.
They were bipedal. I was not a track expert at the time, so I didn't know how to really look, except that I did shine a...
Art Bell in the Kingdom of Nye from west of the Rockies at 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222. And the wildcard line is open at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell from the Kingdom of Nye.
Good morning, everybody. Well, Matt Drudge has done it again, breaking news. You know that American who had been part of the Al-Qaeda. The headline is, Captured American Taliban warns U.S. intelligence of impending bioterror attack by Al-Qaeda. That's the big headline on Drudge at this hour. Breaking news. I'm Art Bell. Robert Morgan is here. And in a moment, I've got a bit of a surprise for you. Stay right there. Into the night once again. Now, suppose I were to tell you, and I've got a couple of police. I've got a friend, a very good friend, named Renee Barnett, who's a television segment producer. And she said, Art, there's something going on with Bigfoot in Oklahoma. And she gave me the names of a couple of police officers in Oklahoma who apparently saw something. Now, I don't know a whole lot about the story beyond that, but there were, I guess, reports of, well, rather than try and guess what it's all about, why don't I bring this officer on the air? He's going to talk to us. His name is Dan. We'll only call him Dan. He's a police officer in Oklahoma. Dan, you're on the air with Robert Morgan and Art Bell. Welcome to the program.
Hey, thanks, guys. Nice to meet you, Robert.
My pleasure, Dan. How are you?
Great.
What's the story here, Dan? Can you even tell us what part of Oklahoma you're in?
Northeastern Oklahoma.
Northeastern. All right.
Around the Tulsa area.
So how did this begin?
Me and my neighbor, he works for the major newspaper in town, and me and him went four-wheeling, and we went up to the northeastern part of the state, went quite a ways back off the road, traveled along the river. We followed the river for quite a ways, real rugged country, just four-wheel drive country.
Sure.
It was just about dark at the beginning of the year, around February, just almost getting dark, come over a little hill and have a straight shot through the woods. You know, the trail just keeps going straight. And approximately 50 feet in front of us, something steps off from the riverside of the road, which is the right side. There was tall grass, real, real tall grass. I want to call it like cane.
Mm-hmm.
Stepped out of the cane and crossed the road, did kind of like the Patterson video, you know, where he turns his whole upper torso, stopped, looked at us, and then kept on trucking right in the woods.
Hmm. How good a look did you get?
We were approximately 50 feet away. We got a pretty good look. It was long reddish brown hair. I didn't see any facial features that I can recall. When it had that swinging arm walk.
Walking on bipedal.
Yeah, 2 feet. Yeah, walking on 2 feet. Approximately, I'm going to guess around 7.5-8 feet tall.
Oh, my.
Yeah, it was big. Walked right across the road and went into the woods, and then we watched exactly where it went to. And it stopped behind some big trees. And like I said, it was the beginning of the year, so all the foliage was still off the trees. So you could see quite a ways back in the woods.
Were you tempted to go after it?
Not at all. Not at all. We pulled up to, we stopped the Jeep in the same location where where we had saw it cross the road.
Right.
And we got out, and we still had a visual on where it had stopped. I got out of the Jeep, picked up a fairly good-sized log, and I heaved it, and nearly hitting the tree that I threw it, that it was hiding behind, and it didn't budge. It stayed there. After that happened, after it didn't move, we both decided that it was best just to get in the Jeep and go ahead and get out of there because, you know, we neither one of us were sure what we had just seen.
Mm-hmm.
It was total silence all the way out of the woods. We didn't talk about it all the way out of the woods. We were pretty much in shock of what we just saw.
I understand. And then apparently, once again, you saw something.
Yeah, approximately about 6 weeks later, I returned with a fellow officer, good friend of mine. We were camping. We got there early that day.
Now, this would be Jeff, right?
That would be Jeff.
Okay.
And we got there early that day, and we were going to meet up with two other people that were going to bring Jeeps, and we were going to go four-wheeling. Got there early, started cooking, started campfire. I was chopping wood, and Jeff was shooting a new gun that he had just purchased, and there's big hills out here, real steep hills. You can't hardly even walk up on them. I started hearing something coming down the hill. Rocks kind of rolling down the hill, branches breaking and stuff. I could hear stuff moving around behind me, and I turn around and I look, and, you know, same time of year, no foliage on the trees. You could see through the woods. It didn't see anything. And so a few minutes later, I hear the noise again, and every time I hear it, it's coming closer. It's approaching. I asked Jeff. He stopped shooting his gun, and I asked him, are you hearing that? And he didn't tune into it right away. Mm. And as it got real close to us, there was a big mound of dirt just behind my back. It was a big mound of dirt, and that's where I was hearing all the noises from. Which the mound of dirt is at the bottom of the hill, and it's approximately about 12 feet tall and about 20 feet long,
mm-hmm.
mound of dirt. And when it got to that point, Jeff started, he began to hear it moving around behind us, and it was fairly close to us. And it sounded like something was crawling on its belly, and it only moved when we were talking or making noise. And if we stopped making any type of noise, it would not move. But if I started to talk again, you could hear it moving around. I mean,
really?
Just very softly moving around.
Uh-huh.
At that time, we both decided to reload the guns,
Good idea.
And grab the flashlights, and we kind of stealthily walked to the end of this mound of dirt, which was probably about 20 feet long, and we walked down a little gravel road. And when we got positioned to the end of the mound of dirt, we both turned on our flashlights, and here's this creature, and it's like either laying flat on its belly or like low kneeling. You know, it's very, very crouched down, very low.
Right.
And when we turn the flashlights on, this thing begins to stand up, and it's big. It's hairy, and it's fairly huge.
Were you able to see any detail?
The long reddish brown hair, again, you know, the basically what I described earlier.
As tall as 6 or 8 feet?
I'd say 7 to 8.
Feet. All right, really big.
Really big, and we're talking less than a distance of 20 feet.
You were really close.
Right up on top of it.
Uh-huh.
It came down the hill and literally came all the way down the hill. And approached us, you know, basically was watching us. I think it was just watching us.
Just watching.
And
Could you see any facial features at all?
Not that I can remember. I don't know if it's shock or what it is, but I cannot remember a facial features.
What about sounds or smells?
I don't remember any smells that night.
Excuse me, did it have anything in its hand at all?
I didn't even notice. If it did, I didn't know. I didn't see it.
So you were just plain in shock.
Yeah, basically, yeah. And as it started to stand up, Jeff turned. Jeff was in front of me. He turned, and he went right past me. And he was heading back for the truck. And I grabbed him by the back of his shirt collar, and I walked backwards with my gun pointed at it the whole time.
You both had guns. You were never tempted to let loose?
No. At one point in time, before we had approached it, when we had both began to hear the noises, when Jeff tuned into it, and there was a lot of rustling around when we were making noise, when I started to hear it and Jeff started to hear it, I shot a few rounds over the top of that mound of dirt before we walked back there.
It is, to me, remarkable. You said that Jeff was firing his gun. As this thing began to approach, now, you would think that the sound of gunfire would absolutely repel anything like this, but obviously either that or it was interested in the gunfire.
Right. It may have been thinking that you were shooting a game of some sort.
Right, and it was looking for the game.
Right. Oh.
And that has happened.
Oh, has it really? You mean a Bigfoot will steal your kill?
Yes, this has happened in the state of Washington while I was in Cougar, Washington. A very similar incident happened to a Marine that was on leave, and he shot an elk. And
the Bigfoot took it?
A large male came down, and he cut loose on the Bigfoot and hit it. But the Bigfoot was coming in for the elk. And a few years prior to that, this was in the early 70s, there had been a hunter that had been killed there that had shot several rounds after he had the elk on the ground and had begun skinning it. And he's fired several rounds, and unfortunately, he was badly beaten.
Dan, have you tried to draw this creature that you and Jeff saw?
No, I have not. Have not.
Did you report this?
Yes, I did. I reported it with David Wilbanks online, and he's at southernbigfoot.com, and that's where my stories, both of the stories that I just told you, are posted at. And since I've met with him in the last 8 months, you know, we've been going back, and we've casted two different sizes of prints. One, which was fairly small.
Oh, you have casted prints?
Yes, we've been back since then. Once after the second encounter with Jeff, I came home and I started looking online. I started looking at Bigfoot. You know, I didn't, because this is something this was all new to me. I'd heard about Bigfoot. You know, I'm only 32 years old, but you know, Bigfoot, you don't hear about it every day. And I started looking online, and I ran across Southern Bigfoot, they're based out of Oklahoma. And I contacted David Wilbanks, and he was real receptive. He came right up here, and the first day we went out there, we casted two tracks,
wow,
really great tracks.
How big?
I'm approximately about 13 inches long, and I'd say about 6.5 inches wide.
Well, officer, you know, maybe you understand now, you know, when a witness has a hard time describing a perp because they were in shock, maybe you understand.
Oh, yeah. I can definitely relate to it now.
Listen, I'm going to... Robert, do you have any questions before I let Dan go?
No, I was going to suggest that perhaps he and his friend, if they logged on to my website, there may be some information there that can help them. And it's at trueseekers.org.
Truthseekers.org.
Trueseekers.org.
All right, we've got to look up.
Go to the American Yeti Expedition section and see if that can be of some help to you. And then if you send me an email with your address, I will send you a copy of our audio cassette and then the new CDs that I'm coming out with, and see if that can help you.
All right, tell me something, Dan. Would you have reported this if you had been alone?
I'm sorry, would I have reported it if there
was... Yeah, in other words, if you had been alone when this occurred instead of with another police officer, would you have reported this?
No.
Yeah, that's what I thought.
Being a police officer, no, I already know.
Okay.
I have one question, one more.
Yeah, sure.
If you don't mind. And that is, when you were, your friend was firing his weapon, his new weapon, was it a high-powered a weapon or a small caliber?
It was a Desert Eagle 44. It was a big gun, big handgun. Yeah.
I guess it was. Okay, I was curious as to that. Sometimes they'll come to target practice and watch.
And when we both had a target picture, you know, we both had guns drawn and a target picture, to shoot at, and we're both trained, you know, to kill. And at no time did either one of us, it never crossed either one of our minds to go ahead and shoot it, because we knew we were, you know, the caliber of weapons that we had were just too small.
Glad you didn't do it anyway, for lots of other reasons.
Yeah.
Well, all right.
And he never threatened you, did he?
No. We had gone back since, and I know what you were going to say to that about you're glad that I didn't shoot it because of the theory that if there's one, there's probably at least one more there.
You bet.
And we have gone back since, and I've heard rocks clacking together on one side of the camp. I mean, we're talking 10 feet in the woods, and 20 feet on the other side of the woods, you'd hear rocks clacking and movement and so on and so forth.
Well, Dan, in the same area, have there been locals reporting anything like this?
Several.
That's what Renee told me, that there have been reports of entire Bigfoot families and all kinds of things in your area.
Right.
Have the police there, have you all had official reports?
No, I haven't checked on the official reports. I've talked to several of the people that have lived there all their life, several of the business people that have worked there and lived there all their life, and they've all either seen or heard several stories about Bigfoot in that area.
Wow. All right, my friend, I really want to thank you for coming on the air tonight.
Thanks, Robert, and thanks, Art.
You bet.
My pleasure.
Good night, Dan. And in a few moments, we'll speak with Jeff as well. He's the other officer who was with Dan. I thought that was kind of strange that the Bigfoot, Robert, would literally, obviously, be attracted to gunfire. But I guess you answered the question. He figures there might be a kill, and he could get it.
Yes, and he obviously has not been shot, and he's obviously also, I'm going to guess, he is a fairly young Bigfoot, even though he's full grown. He doesn't have the experience. The older ones will definitely shy away. So he is a young one and probably has moved into a new family area, and he's taking advantage of it. He's probably frightened some hunters away from their kills already. And that's like habituating a bear. It's not a good idea.
Robert, what are these things?
Yes. Well, in a capsule form, it'll probably have some people screaming bloody murder. I have the feeling that they are the body ancestors to ourselves. They are the prototype that is so perfectly adapted to this earth. And then what has happened is there have been mutations or whatever causes these genetic changes to happen.
Along came humans.
Yeah, and along came humans.
But we're not so well adapted. I mean, we don't have the hair and the protection for being outside. Mostly we need to live inside, unless we're in a sort of a semi-tropical environment. Other than that, we need protection. We've got this skin, hardly any hair at all, and... You know, we can suffer and die very quickly in the elements if we don't know what we're doing. We're not adapted very well at all for the elements.
We're terribly adapted, actually. And without the assistance of animal skins to make leather and all this other sorts of things, we have a very tough time surviving. So we are the only unbalancing feature in all of nature.
I'm curious, how many reports like the one you just heard from a police officer... And here to come, I don't know whether it's his partner, but another police officer backing him up. How frequently do you get reports of this caliber?
Oh, quite a few, and it's usually behind. I must really take my hat off to these gentlemen. Most police officers speak among themselves, but they never go public because there's a possibility they could lose their jobs if they have the wrong kind of. People around them. In Ohio, for instance, someplace I'm very familiar, they had quite a few sightings. And I questioned that myself, and I went down to the sheriff's department.
Right.
And so happened my cousin was a sheriff officer, and some of their most senior officers took me into one of those questioning rooms, closed the door, and then told me what they themselves had seen. But they had been given an order by the sheriff in this county, that if they discussed it, they would lose their jobs.
You know,
because they can't protect you. They're afraid, and there's religious problems there.
Just like there is all across society.
It is so sad, and why we can't face the truth, but it's not in the index of a lot of our books.
I just want to understand the truth about what these things are. Hold on, Robert. We're at the top of the hour. My guest is Robert Morgan. He's perhaps one of the world's greatest Bigfoot experts. And in a moment, you'll hear from yet another police officer, the telephone lines allowing, who also witnessed and backs up the story of Dan. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell. This is Coast to Coast AM.
Kingdom of Nye, from west of the Rockies, dial 1-800-618-8255. East of the Rockies, 1-800-825-5033. First-time callers may reach Art at 1-775-727-1222 or use the wildcard line at 1-775-727-1295. To reach Art on the toll-free international line, call your AT&T operator and have them dial 800-893-0903. This is Coast to Coast AM with Art Bell on the Premier Radio Network.
Robert Morgan is my guest, and because the officer I have on the line right now is actually on patrol, I suspect in his patrol car right now, we're going to hold the break for a moment and with Robert Morgan go directly back to Oklahoma to a patrol car and an officer named Jeff. Jeff, are you there? Wait a minute. Let's punch the button. Jeff, are you there?
Yes. How are you doing this morning, Art?
Hi, Jeff. You're in the same police department as Dan?
Actually, he works for one just to the east of me.
Okay, so you're adjacent towns.
Yes.
But you know each other quite well.
Yeah, we actually used to work for the same department back in 95.
Oh, okay. All right. Were you ever partners?
Yes, we were, actually.
Oh, you were?
Yes.
All right. Well, I'm sure you got to hear Dan's story. I sure would like to get your take and obviously just reinforce what he said.
Right.
So
I guess I'll start with, we had went to the woods. We were pretty far off the main road. We'd, like you said, we'd went down along the river, and we found this place that we were going to camp at that evening, and had started to set up camp. And I had bought a new pistol the week before and had brought it along. I was going to test fire it and try and get used to it. I guess I fired probably about 20 rounds or so, and Dan had kept on asking me if I'd heard some rustling or something up on this hill, and I hadn't heard it. I'd been shooting, and once he'd pointed it out, I still didn't, it didn't come to me as far as I could hear it.
Well, your hearing was probably impaired.
Right. That 44 Magnum is pretty loud.
Yeah.
But we'd decided to cook a little bit of dinner. It was just before dusk, and we turned the radio on the truck, and we're sitting back, and we're eating, and it was starting to get dark, and Dan had pointed it out again to me, and that time I'd heard it, and it was just like a quiet rustling in the in the leaves, probably, I'd say, no more than 50 yards over the edge of this berm. And it seemed like it was getting closer. And once it got, I would say, probably 20 yards away from us, it actually seemed like it was starting to circle us.
Oh.
First it was going to the left, and then it started coming back to the right. And we're talking a pretty extended period of time, because it was dark by the time it started coming back to the right. I would say probably 30 to 45 minutes that we were actually had turned the radio off and were listening. And in that time is when Dan had fired, five or six rounds over this hill. We're thinking if it's, an animal out there, it's going to run away, and it's not going to bother us. But if it's somebody out there messing with us, they're going to say, hey, I'm over here, don't shoot.
Right, sure.
And nothing. It didn't run away, and there was nobody out there, saying, hey, there's somebody out here, don't be shooting. And I'll be quite honest with you, I was starting to get a little anxious.
Mm-hmm. Well, Dan told us about the confrontation. In other words, that you got around there with flashlights.
Right.
And you shine flashlights on this creature. And Dan said it raised itself up. And was probably, he said, about 8 feet tall. You concur with that?
At least 8 feet tall.
He didn't really get much of a look at the face because he admitted he was in shock. And I can imagine you may well have been, too. Did you get any sort of look at its face?
At the face, no. No, I didn't. In fact, the first thing that crossed my mind when I saw it was, it's time to get out of here.
Yeah.
And I was headed to the truck, and I was leaving with whether Dan was coming with me or not.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Did you mention that to Dan?
Actually, when he grabbed a hold of my shirt, I figured he had the idea because I told him, I'm going with the truck, and we're getting out of here.
You did say we.
Yeah.
Good. All right. So then you really concur with everything he said. Is there anything he said you can add to?
Other than, it really did seem like it was maybe crawling on all fours. When I first saw it, it was as if it was standing up and like it was on its knees. And even when it was on its knees, it appeared to be at least 5.5 to 6 feet tall.
Aye, aye, aye.
And as it stood up, that's when, I don't know if you want to call it fight or flight, but I was ready to fly away and get as far away, as fast away as I could.
Makes all the sense in the world to me. You, too, had a gun.
Yes.
And you had reloaded, and you were all ready to go. You could have fired that weapon. Why didn't you?
It never even crossed my mind. In fact, until I got back in the truck, I didn't realize that I had the gun in my hand. I knew I had it, but it didn't cross my mind until I tried to open the truck door, and there was the gun in the way.
Very, very interesting. So, in other words, you totally back up Dan's story all the way.
Yes.
Jeff, one last question. How have your fellow officers reacted to what the two of you have said?
I think I might have told one other officer that I work with about it, my partner that works with me now on Midnights. But I didn't tell my wife about it for over a month after it happened. And other than her and my partner now, I've told my dad and my uncle, and that was only a month ago. I haven't talked to anybody about it.
You think you saw Bigfoot?
I know I did.
Robert, any questions for Jeff? I see what happened. All right, we lost Robert. All right, well, listen, Jeff.
Okay.
Thank you. I can't thank you enough for coming on.